Can you all hear me? Yes, okay. So I have to start with an apology. As you can probably hear, I have a cold. So there will be some coughing and sneezing, I'm afraid, while I talk. But I'll do my best. As you just heard, I'm a particle physicist by training, a theoretical particle physicist, to be precise. And the pride of the field of particle physics is currently the Large Hadron Collider at CERN in Geneva. The Large Hadron Collider is a tunnel at a depth of about 100 meters, which is 25 kilometers in circumference. And in that tunnel, there are a lot of magnets that accelerate protons, which are then brought to controlled collisions at four places where experiments measure what happens if the protons collide. The purpose of that exercise is to find out what matter is ultimately made of. The Large Hadron Collider, as you have probably heard, has found the Higgs boson that was announced in 2012. The Higgs boson is the last particle to complete what is called the standard model of particle physics. You may also recall that before the LHC turned on in 2010, a lot of physicists expressed themselves very confident that the Large Hadron Collider would also find something else. There was a lot of talk about it may be discovering the particles that dark matter is made of, or the so-called supersymmetric particles, or maybe large extra dimensions. Some were talking about making contact to parallel universes. So yes, that's something that people talked about. And nothing of that kind has happened. Why has this not happened? Well, I think I will not give away too much if I say that I think they have been led astray by beauty, because it's in the title of the talk. And I hope that I will be able to give you somewhat of an impression what I think has happened here. Actually, this week there's a conference going on, Rencontre de Mondrian, which is one of the major conferences in the field of particle physics where the newest results are being discussed. Among others, the results that have come out of the most recent LHC data, and they still have not found any of the promised new particles. Before I say anything else, I have to tell you more precisely what part of physics I'm talking about. So I always emphasize I'm only talking about a specific area of physics, which I call the foundations of physics. There are a lot of other fields of physics that I'm not talking about, you know, condensed matter physics, plasma physics, optics, quantum optics, what have you, crystallography, atomic and nuclear physics, and so on. So physics is the large field. I'm talking about the foundations of physics, by which I mean those natural laws which, for all we currently know, cannot be derived from any underlying laws. And we currently have two theories in the foundations of physics. The one is the standard model of particle physics that I already mentioned. The standard model contains 25 particles, one of which is the Higgs. Those particles make up all the matter in the universe, and the standard model describes how these particles interact. The other theory that we have in the foundations of physics is Einstein's theory of general relativity, which describes the behavior of space and time. What has been happening in that field as of recently? Not a terrible lot. There has been a lot of talk about a crisis in physics, a crisis at the edge of physics, at the foundations of physics, had something to do with supersymmetry. Could there be a crisis in physics? Another crisis in physics. Is theoretical physics in crisis? Yeah, you could get the impression. This is my favorite. This is a new one that appeared in New Scientist 2 months ago or something. We will die before we find the answer. That's a quote from Neil Turok, who's currently director of Perimeter Institute. That is one of the most prestigious research institutes in the foundations of physics. I don't particularly like all that talk about crisis, because personally, I think crisis is too optimistic. It gives you the impression that people in those fields have understood that something is going wrong and they're thinking about it, but actually nothing like this is happening. Therefore, I prefer to call it stagnation. Nothing is happening here. The theory of general relativity is more than 100 years old. The development of the standard model was largely completed in the mid-1970s, and since then, the mathematical structure of those theories has not changed. So yes, we have added a few parameters after this. Certainly in the 1970s, not all the particles in the standard model had actually been measured. As I already said, the final particle has only been actually confirmed in 2012. We have also added neutrino masses to the standard model, but the theory for this comes from the 1950s. Also, the theory for the Higgs boson comes from the 1960s. To general relativity, we have added the so-called cosmological constant after astrophysicists noticed that the universe expands at an accelerating pace. But the cosmological constant was already introduced originally by Einstein. The point is that the theories by themselves, for what the mathematics is concerned, have not changed. But it's not like physicists are done and can just, you know, pack and go home. We know that that's not it. We have unsolved problems in the foundations of physics. The biggest one is that the standard model does not fit together with general relativity. You probably noticed that on the original slide I had these two theories separate from each other. That's because they don't like to communicate with each other. The problem is not all that hard to understand. We know that the constituents of matter have quantum properties. That means, among other things, that they obey Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, and they can be in very specific ways in two places at once. That's what's called a quantum superposition. The best example of this is the double slit experiment, where a particle can actually go two ways at the same time. So that's what we mean by a quantum superposition. We also know that these particles have masses, and we do know that masses generate a gravitational pull. So that brings up the question, if you have a particle that goes to two slits at the same time, where does the gravitational pull go? You would expect that this gravitational pull also goes to two different places. But this cannot happen in Einstein's theory of general relativity because it cannot deal with quantum properties. It's what we call a classical theory or pre-quantum theory. So there's this question, you know, that you can ask in a single sentence, where does the gravitational pull go of that particle, to which we just do not have an answer. So that's one of the open problems. We also have very good astrophysical evidence that the universe contains a type of matter that is the so-called dark matter. It's a bad word, I think, because it's not that the matter is dark, it's actually transparent. It does neither absorb nor emit light. We know that it has to be there, we're fairly confident about this, but we don't know what it is made of. We know that it cannot be any of the particles in the standard model. They don't have the right properties. Actually, I should be fair that there is an alternative explanation to our observations. One is that there has to be additional matter out there, which we don't know what it is. The other possibility is that actually Einstein's theory of general relativity is not the right theory of gravity, but that we need to have a modified theory of gravity to explain the observations. Either way, we have to change something about the foundations of physics. Then we have a lot of other questions like how did the universe begin? We still haven't really figured that out, and some others. So it's a long list, but those are, I think, the most important questions. So definitely, physicists are not done with the foundations. And those are hard questions, there's no doubt about this. Physics is a very mature discipline. It's one of the oldest sciences, and the simple things have been done. That's true both for the theoretical development as well as for the experiments. So it's unsurprising that things slow down. And indeed, this is not what I'm worried about. This is also one of the reasons why I don't like this talk about crisis, because you know, it's a, how would you know that you are in a crisis? How would you know that it could have been any anything else? The situation could have been any other. I think the better question to ask is whether progress is as fast as it could be. Are we really doing the best that we can? And I think the answer to this is almost certainly not, because physicists focus on the wrong problems. And I now want to give you an impression of what has happened here. I want to say ahead that I'm not a historian. I'm a theoretical physicist. So this is my interpretation of the history of physics. But since my book has been published, I've gotten a lot of feedback from philosophers and historians, and they assured me that I got it basically right. So I have some confidence that what I'm telling you is not completely wrong. I want to start with Isaac Newton about 400 years ago, for whom beauty used to be a sign of godly influence. So he wrote, "This most beautiful system of the sun, planets, and comets could only proceed from the counsel and dominion of an intelligent being." I'm picking Newton here to represent his time. He was certainly not the only one who conflated nature with God. It was just something that the scientists at the time did. So the argument is basically, God is wise, and certainly if God made the universe, then the universe has to be beautiful. So I move on by several hundred years to the end of the 19th century, to Henri Poincaré, for whom beauty became a bonus of the scientific profession. So at this time, scientists were trying to get rid of this closeness to religion. And Poincaré wrote, "The scientist does not study nature because it is useful to do so. He studies it because he takes pleasure in it, and he takes pleasure in it because it is beautiful." Then we have here Hermann Weyl, who seems to have been the first to actually use beauty as a guide to the development of new natural law. Hermann Weyl was a mathematician, actually, but he has done some very influential work for general relativity. And he wrote, "My work always tries to unite the true with the beautiful, but when I had to choose one or the other, I usually choose the beautiful." Paul Dirac took it one step further. Paul Dirac won a Nobel Prize for the Dirac equation that explains the behavior of the electron. For Paul Dirac, beauty really was a mandate for the theoretical physicist. He wrote, "The research worker in his efforts to express the fundamental laws of nature in mathematical form should strive mainly for mathematical beauty." And as physicists became more successful, they became increasingly convinced that they can understand nature by introspection. So here we have Albert Einstein, who of course should not be missing from the list. He wrote, "I'm convinced that we can discover by means of purely mathematical constructions the concepts and the laws connecting them with each other, which furnish the key to the understanding of natural phenomena. In a certain sense, therefore, I hold it true that pure thought can grasp reality as the ancients dreamed." Yeah, so I should be fair to Albert Einstein that in other circumstances he has pointed out the need to rely on observational guidance as well. So with that, I want to leave behind the realm of the already deceased and come to those who are still alive, starting with Anthony Zee, who is a professor for physics at the University of California in Santa Barbara. And in the 1980s, he wrote a book that's called something with symmetry, keep forgetting the title. And in this book, he wrote, "My colleagues and I, we are the intellectual descendants of Albert Einstein. We like to think that we too search for beauty." So this generation inherited this belief that beauty is a good guide to development of nature from those who had previously been successful. Then we have Steven Weinberg. Steven Weinberg is also a Nobel Prize winner. He won the Nobel Prize for the development of the standard model. He wrote a book in the 1990s called Dreams of a Final Theory. And in this book, he makes this comparison to a horse breeder. The horse breeder looks at a horse and says, that's a beautiful horse. While he or she may be expressing a purely aesthetic emotion, I think there's more to it than that. The horse breeder has seen lots of horses, and from experience with horses, knows that that's the kind of horse that wins races. So what he's trying to say here is that beauty is experience. We learn to recognize successful theories as scientists, the same way that the horse breeder learns to recognize successful horses, and that's what we come to mean by beauty. And that's all well and fine as long as you stick with the same type of theory, or as long as you continue to breed horses and not, drive racing cars. So Steven Weinberg is one of the people who I interviewed for my book, he already said. Another Nobel Prize winner, Murray Gell-Mann. Gell-Mann won also Nobel Prize in his case for the development of the quark model. The quarks are also fundamental particles that are in the standard model. And he said the following in a TED talk that you find online. What is especially striking and remarkable is that in fundamental physics, a beautiful or elegant theory is more likely to be right than a theory that is inelegant. I don't think that's correct, but that's what he clearly believes. And I have a final quote. This one is from Robert Dijkgraaf, who is currently the director of the Princeton Institute for Advanced Study. He is a string theorist, and he has written the following. Once you have understood the language of which the universe is written, it is extremely elegant, beautiful, powerful, and natural. The universe wants to be understood, and that's why we are all driven by this urge to find an all-encompassing theory. So you see what has happened here is that the generation of physicists around the turn of the previous century invented this notion of beauty as a guide, and the following generation continued to use it in the same way, except that for them it didn't work. Before I say anything further, I have to tell you exactly what theoretical physicists mean by beauty. So for my book, I traveled around and I asked a lot of theoretical physicists just what they mean by beauty. And one of the surprising things that I found is that they all largely agreed on what they mean by beauty. So I want to be clear here that I don't want to tell anyone what beauty means. You can all find beautiful whatever you want to be beautiful. I just want to tell you what theoretical physicists normally mean when they speak about beauty. And I brought you a little photo of a flower arrangement that my kids made in the garden last year, which I think summarizes the typical kinds of beauty that particle physicists, or more generally people in the foundations of physics, refer to. So the first obvious thing that you see is that it has a lot of symmetry. That's fairly obvious. It's also simple. You know, it's not a prize-winning artwork. And it is also natural in an obvious way. It's not too rigid. You know, it has some randomness sprinkled over it. And it's those three ingredients are the same elements of beauty that physicists like to see in their theories. Let me start with simplicity. So there is relative simplicity, which is a good scientific criterion. This is not what I'm talking about. This is basically Occam's razor that says, among several theories that achieve the same, you pick the simplest one. And so that's all well and fine. This is not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about absolute simplicity. You want a theory that is simple, period. in the sense that it has very few assumptions. A typical example here would be that in a standard model, we have three types of forces. There's the electromagnetic force, and then there's the strong and the weak nuclear force, so that's three. Particle physicists would rather have only one. That would be a unified force, because that would be simpler. So typically, in the foundations of physics, the way that you make a theory simpler is by symmetry requirements or by unifying principles. And that is certainly experience-based to some extent, because unification, simplification has been successful in the history of physics over and over again. We have unified the electric with the magnetic force and the electromagnetic with the weak nuclear force. And there are earlier examples of unification, like it turns out that different kinds of energies are actually the same, and so on and so forth. So, and this is all well and fine, except that it is purely hypothetical that as we look deeper into the fundamental laws of nature, it has to continue to get simpler. There's just no way to know that. It just may not be true. Another problem is the world is only so simple. You know, it has to stop at some point. I already mentioned Occam's razor. Occam's razor, of course, only tells you something about theories that actually describe the world. You know, there are a lot of theories that you can think of that are definitely simple, but just don't describe the universe we inhabit. An obvious example would be universe that does not contain any matter. Well, that would definitely be simpler than the universe that we have here. It's just wrong. Similar story, for example, with the attempt to quantize gravity in two dimensions. You know, it's much easier than in four dimensions, but we don't live in two dimensions. So starting from absolute simplicity just does not work. You always need the additional requirement that it actually describes what you see. And as an example from art, I have here a photo from a style that's called minimalism. Then there's naturalness. People who have little to do with the foundations of physics always find this aspect of naturalness to be the hardest to understand aspect of beauty. I also brought you a photo here, which I took myself, field of sunflowers. You've probably seen a lot of sunflower fields, so I don't have to tell you all that much about it. The sunflowers are all pretty much the same height, and they have all pretty much the same size. They're not exactly the same height, and they're not exactly the same size, but kind of equalish. You would be very surprised if you walked by a field of sunflowers and you saw a sunflower that was 100 kilometers high. You would say, well, that needs some explaining. And it's exactly this element of surprise that theoretical physicists associate with something that is unnatural. So in general, this notion of naturalness is that numbers without units should be of order one. So it's important that they actually be without units, because if you have a number that has units, you can make it to be anything you want. In particle physics in particular, there is a more specific notion of naturalness, the so-called technical naturalness, according to which small numbers are allowed if there is an explanation for why they are small. An explanation for such a number can, for example, be a symmetry. So you get this trade-off between naturalness and symmetry. And now this brings me back to what I said in the very beginning about particle physicists expecting there to be other particles besides the Higgs boson to find at the Large Hadron Collider. Why was that? Well, it was because of technical naturalness. There is one constant in the standard model which is not technically natural, and that's the mass of the Higgs boson. Mass of the Higgs boson is small, but there is no explanation for that. So that's considered very ugly. Now, what you can do is you can amend the standard model and add new types of symmetries, which will explain why this number of small is small. And those amended versions of the standard model will contain additional particles that have to appear near the mass of the Higgs boson. So they basically should appear together. That was the reason why all those theoretical physicists believed that the Large Hadron Collider has to see something new, because they could not believe that the standard model would contain a number that is just small for no particular reason. So those two notions of naturalness have in common that they try to avoid improbable parameters. If you think of the example with the sunflower, you know something about sunflowers. You know how they grow. You would think that it's very unlikely that a sunflower grows to a height of 100 kilometers. But of course, that's because you have collected a lot of statistics. You've probably seen a lot of fields, not only sunflower fields, but also other fields. You have an expectation that is based on accumulated data. And now the problem is that the way that physicists use this argument when it comes to the fundamental laws of nature is not about a situation where they actually have collected any statistics, because they're talking about the values of parameters in the fundamental theories that they have. And we have only one universe with that one set of parameters. We have no statistics, and therefore we have no way to tell whether those parameters are likely or unlikely. This whole idea of naturalness is just ill-defined in the mathematical sense. And without a good mathematical definition, it's just an argument from beauty. Then there is the third aspect of beauty, which is quite vague. It's usually referred to as elegance. So that's basically when you get much out of little. You want a theory that is simple, yes, but you don't want it to be too simple, because that would be boring. So philosophers sometimes call that unexpected explanatory closure, when you have your aha moment, when something clicks into place. Other people has expressed it as a theory that makes new connections or that brings you surprising insights. So I have also here an example of an image. This is an art style that is called fluid art. You find a lot of nice videos on YouTube that will show you how this is made. It's basically a mixture of acrylic colors that you pour into a glass together with some chemicals, and then you top over the glass on a canvas, and it will make those interesting patterns. So it's a very simple idea, but it has some surprising effects. In theoretical physics, a good example for a theory that is considered to be very elegant is Einstein's theory of general relativity. So it's actually a very simple theory if you write down Einstein's field equations. So maybe Einstein would not have agreed that it was all that simple, because it took him a long time to actually derive those equations. But if you, but that was because he did not have the mathematical formalism already. He had to develop that. He had to develop that along with his theory. But today, if you have an education in differential geometry and maybe also topology, then writing down those equations is not all that difficult. But those simple equations have a lot of surprising consequences. For example, gravitational waves that we have already recently been able to directly detect. They also give rise to black holes, maybe to wormholes, to gravitational lensing. Gravitational redshift, and so on and so forth. So that there are a lot of things that fall out of those equations that you would not expect by looking at them. Another theory that is likewise considered to be very elegant is string theory. So the idea of string theory is very simple. Everything is made of strings. But it turns out if you try to formulate this theory in a mathematically rigorous way, then it develops its own will. You know, it will force on you certain conclusions that you would not originally have expected. For example, that we have to live in 10-dimensional space-time. So theory tells you that. It will also tell you that we actually need to have supersymmetry in the universe. So string theory, too, is considered to be a very elegant theory. The problem with this argument of elegance is that, what do you know what I actually truly find surprising? You know, the more time you spend with a certain theory, the less surprising you will find the consequences of it. So it's really a very subjective criterion that depends a lot on your experience and also on your education. So taken together, I call those three elements of beauty, the hidden rules of physics. Those are criteria that pretty much everyone is currently using in the foundations of physics if they have to select a theory, but no one really talks about it. Instead, what has happened is that those criteria have become converted into technical requirements, particularly obvious when it comes to technical naturalists, and their status as hypothesis has become forgotten. And this is why my book is called Lost in Math, because those are really philosophical principles. I call them aesthetic principles or aesthetic arguments. Other people have told me that I should call it metaphysical arguments or maybe just beliefs, whatever you want to call it. The point is that those are additional requirements that are not based on evidence that theoretical physicists are using to select hypotheses. So does it at least work to rely on beauty as a guide to the development of natural laws? The answer is no. There are a lot of examples in the history of physics where that has clearly not worked. Probably the best known example are the Platonic solids that you see here. So this is a set of five regular polyhedra that, according to Kepler, should be stacked inside each other to determine the orbits of the then known five planets. So that was wrong to begin with because there are more than five planets and also the orbits are not circular. The thing with the circular orbit was another beautiful idea that eventually did not pan out. The orbits are actually elliptic, as you probably all know. But that was originally considered to be a very ugly thing. So clearly on that account, beauty standards have changed. You ask any astronomer or astrophysicist today, and no one would tell you that elliptic orbits are ugly. That would just be ridiculous. There's also an interesting episode in the history of physics around the turn of the 19th to the 20th century, where a theory by name vortex theory became very popular. According to vortex theory, atoms are actually knots in an invisible ether. So for the mathematician, a knot has to be closed so there are no loose ends. And you can classify all those knots. I've brought you an example here. So, you know, it has symmetry. It has an obvious appeal to the eye, I think. And people calculate a lot of this, this stuff. Never made any contact to observation, and this whole idea became totally obsolete with the discovery of quantum mechanics that could describe the structure of the periodic system. Another example of a beautiful theory that did not work is the steady state universe. So originally, it was considered to be beautiful to have a universe that is eternally unchanging, that has just always been the same that it is now and will continue to be so forever. And it came as somewhat of a shock when Einstein's theory of general relativity turned out to imply that the universe has to be dynamic and actually changes in time. But it turns out to be correct. The universe is not eternally unchanging. It came out of a Big Bang. So in that case, too, the beautiful idea did not work. And then there are several prominent physicists' late years idea of unified theories. One example of which is Werner Heisenberg, who wrote sometime in the 1950s in a letter to his sister that these interrelations display in all their mathematical abstraction an incredible degree of simplicity as a gift we can only accept humbly. Not even Plato could have believed them to be so beautiful. And so he was not referring to his theory of quantum mechanics, which has been extremely successful. But he was referring to his attempt at a unified theory of everything that he was working on at the time. And he was very confident that he was close to the right answer, confident enough to give lectures about it. And at one of those lectures, he must have given an interview to some journalist whom he told that he has it all worked out, only the details are missing. And that pissed off his colleague, Wolfgang Pauli, who on this occasion wrote a postcard to his friend Georg Gamow, on which he drew an empty rectangle and wrote, "This is to show the world that I can paint like Titian, only technical details are missing." Why have you never heard anything of Heisenberg's great theory of the unified interactions? Because it worked pretty badly, and when Heisenberg passed away, the theory passed away with him. And then on the other side, we have ugly ideas that work just fine. The best example I could think of is this flytrap. Definitely ugly, also works very well. In the foundations of physics, we have quantum mechanics. I always have to add that personally, I don't find quantum mechanics ugly, but a lot of people find it ugly. It works just fine. Then in quantum field theory, we have a mathematical procedure that's called regularization that a lot of people, especially Dirac, consider to be very ugly. What's happening there is that a lot of the time, if you try to calculate what happens in a measurement, the answer that you get from the theory is actually infinity, which is not very useful. So then you have to jump through some hoops to get rid of that infinite part and find the physically meaningful finite remainder. And that is called regularization. Works just fine, predicts observations very well, but a lot of people think that it is very inelegant. Then there are, I already said this, the elliptical orbits that were considered to be ugly, and the Big Bang theory. So what's the scorecard for beauty? Well, sometimes it works, sometimes it does not. There's also no reason to think that it does work to develop natural laws by relying on the human sense of beauty. The human sense of beauty certainly has some hardwired part. In particular, our liking of symmetry is probably something that we are born with. Psychologists believe that it's because symmetric organisms are more likely to be healthy. Our sense of beauty also has a cultural part. It also changes as we grow up. And there's just generally no reason to think that this should tell us anything about the working of the foundations of physics. So evolution just did not prepare us to look for laws that dictate the behavior of things that we can't see. It certainly has some experience value. So this is what Weinberg was trying to get at in his speech with the horse breeder. But that is of limited use to develop new theories. Indeed, there is a philosopher of science by name McAllister who has argued that any time we have a paradigm shift in the foundations of physics, it's actually our ideals of beauty that shift. So, in summary, aesthetic criteria are based on experience, but we have no way of knowing that they will continue to be useful. The scientific approach would be to use them as hypotheses and see if they work. And if they don't work, then we should discard them. But that has not happened. Instead, we have used the same criteria of beauty for 40 years, and they have not worked for that a long time. See, what this has led to is what I call the vicious cycle of lacking data. It takes increasingly more time and money to test new theories. If we now want to probe new fundamental laws in physics, we have to build particle colliders that take 20 to 30 years to build, cost $10 to $20 billion, something like this. So we have to choose careful which theories to test. If we choose the wrong theory to test, then we will just get null results, which means we get results that confirm the already existing theories instead of finding something new. So yes, null results are also results, but they're not particularly useful results if you want to develop a new theory. What you really want is data that tells you something about new effects that you can use to guide the development of a theory. And this creates a vicious cycle, because you start with an unpromising theory, then you commission an experiment to look for that, you only get negative results, you have a lack of data, so you have no guidance to develop your theory, you get stuck with the unpromising theory, and the whole thing repeats. And in foundational physics, we have been in that cycle for several decades. Here's some example of such failed predictions. I'm afraid this is maybe a little bit technical. This is the most technical slide of the talk. So in the standard model, there is a number that's called the theta parameter, which is small, but no one knows why it is small. So this is an example of an unnatural number. And as I already told you, this is considered to be a very ugly thing. So already in the 1970s, people try to come up with a way to explain why that number is small, and that can be done by making that parameter into a dynamical field that has a potential and then it rolls down in the potential, and that explains why it's small. That's all well and fine. And then Frank Wilczek and Steven Weinberg independently, coincidentally, at almost the same time, realized that if you do that, then this parameter will be accompanied by a particle. That particle was called the axion, and it was ruled out pretty much as quickly as it had been invented. They looked for it, and they didn't see any evidence of it. What happened after this is not that they discarded of this hypothesis. Instead, they invented more complicated types of axions that would not be as easy to see in the data. And since then, they have been building experiments to look for those more difficult to find axions, which have become known as the invisible axions. They didn't find them because the trouble is that they're invisible. So here's an example of one of those experiments that's still running, still hasn't seen anything. It's a similar story with the so-called weakly interacting massive particles, also known as WIMPs. Those are candidates for dark matter. They have been sought for since the mid-1980s. So far, none of them have been seen. Their interaction probability gets a little bit smaller every time they every time physicists get a null result. Then the theoreticians will claim that actually they expected it to be a little less strongly interacting. So here's an example of one of these experiments. This is called Xenon 1T. Which is an upgrade of Xenon 100, which is an upgrade of Xenon 10, which is an upgrade of the original Xenon experiment. Since the first experiments in the 1980s, the conjectured interaction probability has dropped by more than a factor of 100,000. The major motivation to look for those things is the so-called WIMP miracle. That's a numerical coincidence that was widely considered a convincing argument in favor of WIMPs. The way that this works, roughly speaking, is like this. If you have a particle that interacts with the strength of the weak nuclear force, this is why weakly, and it has masses that you could just about see at the Large Hadron Collider, which now we know has not happened, but that is how the argument went at the time. then you can calculate how many of those particles should have been produced in the early universe. And if you do that, you get a number that is about just right to explain the observed abundance of dark matter. And that is what the WIMP miracle is. It has now been experimentally ruled out. And yes, then I already told you about this. There were lots of predictions for new physics at the Large Hadron Collider. People are sometimes shocked when I say there have been tens of thousands of those predictions, but that's just the number of papers that people have written in which they calculated what was supposed to happen at the Large Hadron Collider, none of which actually did happen. The only particle that they actually saw was the Higgs boson that was predicted already in the 1960s. And that, I have to emphasize, was not a prediction based on an argument from beauty. It was a prediction based on an argument from consistency. I have a little bit more to say about this on the next slide. So here's a modus prodigus proposal that I have for theoretical physicists. Historically, it was resolving real inconsistencies that lead to progress. I have that on the next slide. I should, every time I give this talk, I think I should change the order of those slides, but I keep forgetting about this. So I suggest before you try to solve a problem, you make sure it really is a problem, and lack of beauty is not an inconsistency. So here are the examples of the historical breakthrough problems where something worked. They were all problems of mathematical consistency, where you have an actual disagreement in the theory. For example, the space-time symmetry that Galileo conceived of, which is called Galilean invariance, does not work with the equations of electrodynamics that Maxwell found. If you remove this inconsistency, you get special relativity. And this is what Einstein did. This is why his original paper is called Zur Elektrodynamik bewegter Körper. It was about what happens if you move stuff in electrodynamics. Then it turns out that special relativity does not work together with Newtonian gravity. If you resolve this disagreement, you get general relativity. It also turns out that special relativity does not work with the original formulation of quantum mechanics. If you resolve this disagreement, you get the Dirac equation. So this is what Dirac is famous for. And after some further steps, you eventually get to quantum field theory, which the standard model is based on. The Higgs 2 was a prediction based on a consistency problem. It's without the Higgs, you just cannot make predictions with the standard model at the energies that the LHC probes. The theory just does not work. This in and by itself does not tell you that this consistency has to be solved by the Higgs. It only tells you that something had to happen at the Large Hadron Collider. The Higgs was the simplest way to solve that problem, and the Higgs was the correct one. But before we had the LHC, there were other options on the table. But the biggest question of all is, if arguments from beauty work so badly, why do physicists continue to use them? Like, I'm certainly not the first to say that beauty is not a scientific argument. You don't need to have a Nobel Prize to understand that. The plausible reason, I think, is they do it because everyone else does it too. They see that everyone does it, it's what they have learned. They think it's normal scientific procedure. They're certainly aware that arguments from beauty are not scientific. Here's an example from Brian Greene's book, The Elegant Universe, where he writes, aesthetic judgments do not arbitrate scientific discourse. Yeah, that sounds good, right? It's all well and fine. But then he, you know, there's a paragraph in between, but then he goes on. But it is certainly the case that some decisions made by theoretical physicists are founded upon an aesthetic sense, like, for example, string theory, right? And he's not the only one who says something like that. If you read popular science books about theoretical physics, they will go on about how beautiful those theories are without end. Now, this is certainly not a problem specific to physics. We see similar things happening in very other disciplines, where I mean that methodologies that are clearly bad and that everyone knows are bad are continued to be used nevertheless. Here's an example from the life sciences, which I found in those actually very scary book by Richard Harris, which is called Rigor Mortis, in which he explains what is going on in the life sciences with mislabeled cell lines and contaminated antibodies, and the whole thing just, you know, freaked me out. I had no idea it's so bad. But so one thing he goes on about are mice models, probably something a lot of you know more about than I do. So it turns out that actually the results from mice are not all that useful if you want to learn something about humans, which is widely known. The results from mice in many cases actually don't even transfer to rats. Why do people keep using mice? Because they're cheap and they reproduce quickly, and because everyone else does it. Similar story also in sociology and psychology, where people have been using flawed measures for statistical significance for decades. This is something that everyone knew about, like even I knew about this. I had some arguments about this with psychologists decades ago or something, and they just did not want to hear that there was anything wrong with that because it was what everyone else was doing. So the president of the American Statistical Association wrote the following in 2016, "Statisticians and other scientists have been writing on the topic for decades." So clearly everyone knew it. And then there are those psychologists who summed up their assessment of the situation as follows. Everyone knew it was wrong, but they thought it was wrong the way it's wrong to jaywalk. In other words, it's okay because everyone else does it too. So what can we do about this? There are two things we can do. One thing is that we can cure the symptoms. We can find field-specific ways to prevent the use of bad methodology. And indeed, this is happening already in the life sciences and also in sociology and psychology. We can enforce better criteria for statistical significance. Just last week, by the way, there was a comment in Nature magazine where a group of sociologists, I think, called on the community to end the use of p-values, which can be very misleading. So this is an example of people actually trying to cure the symptoms. In the life sciences, you can ask people to pre-register trials. You would do that to avoid that they change the hypothesis after they have seen the data. And similarly, in the foundations of physics, we could certainly, you know, ask particle physicists to please not use criteria from beauty because that's not good scientific procedure. And that will indeed fix the acute problem, but it's bound to come back because you did not actually cure the underlying disease. So what is the underlying disease? Well, the problem is that academia currently does not work properly because scientists don't take account of how being part of a group affects their judgment. As I told you, they think that what they're doing is just fine because everyone else is doing it too, because it's what they have learned to do. So there's a very strong sociological effect that people are just not aware of. They're very, very certain that what they're doing is the right thing. You will hear that if you talk with them. You know, I encourage you to try that. Find yourself some theoretical physicists and ask them if they believe anything that what I've just told them. You know, it doesn't matter whatsoever that I can show you, well, this method has not worked for 40 years. They still think it's the right thing to do and will continue to do it. So in summary, using criteria of beauty to assess theories is bad scientific methodology, but unfortunately, bad methodologies can become accepted norms if sufficiently many people reassure each other that they are doing the right thing. Thank you for your attention.